Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Overwatch. It is the Atlantic Showdown, and it is the road to $100,000, which will be happening at Gamescom. And this is the very beginning, the very start. It's a long old way to go. Jason Kaplan is joining me for this one. He's obviously sorting the production out for us, getting my balance right. He just muted me.
I hit the wrong button. That's how you go. I'm a little tilted today. I
did say you're getting the balance right, and then you just muted me out. It's like, yep, it's all
sounds
me.
Good to me. Sounds great. Sorry for that. Yeah, so our first qualifier for Europe, we have North America coming up on Wednesday. It's going to be great. I'm can't wait to see the teams that get through into our final qualifier.
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, it's going to be big brackets as they go through. We'll get to the top teams as we get there. But at the moment, we're going to be going with eSuba versus the Coin Flippers.
Yeah.
Not exactly teams that you may well know of. eSuba, of course, an old organization, been around for many years. Coin Flippers, a group of Finnish guys. However, for them, there won't be any coin flips.
Yeah, luckily for them, I think. I think everyone's really happy there's no coin flips. But to go over how the tournament works, we should kind of touch on that. There's predetermined maps, at least in a map pool. You're not going to be doing vetoes. There's six maps in total. For this week, we have Dorado, Hollywood, Hanamura, Nepal, Kings Row, and Watchpoint Gibraltar. That's our six maps for this entire week, for these 2 days for NA, and I believe for EU, and then I believe NA is the exact same as well. Mm-hmm. And we have an initial map to start off on each round of the actual tournament. So on the around 128, we start with Kings Row. When we get to the round of 64, it's Dorado. Round of 32, Kings Row. And then the round of 16, it's going to be Hollywood. So you know your initial map. And then to choose the next map in the pool, the losing team gets to choose one of the five remaining maps as your next map of choice.
Yeah, and of course, if it ends in a draw after all of that, it will be Ilios as the decider. Yep. One round of Ilios, all three.
No, it's all three.
Yeah. It is all three now. Yeah. It used to be one round. I'm so used to one round.
Well, you're technically right. So if it's in the normal map pool, it's going to be best of five, like it is a standard competitive mode. If it's in overtime, it's a best of three.
Three, yes. Yes.
And that'll determine what team goes on.
People use the competitive now. It is all five. Yep. We're not going five. It's going to be three. So $100,000 up for grabs, as I mentioned. 16 teams will qualify through to the playoffs. Four of those will be through tomorrow. We're going to be doing Europe today and tomorrow, and then North America on Wednesday and Thursday. So lots of Overwatch action going to be coming up on this channel. Be sure to follow it. Make sure you're going to be following myself and obviously Jason on the Twitter for everything that is going on. I'm going to give the guys the signal, I feel, to say we are ready up. I know one of their guys, Weber, basically just got in. got everywhere. He's like,
I think they said he ran out of the taxi, sprinted home. I think he probably threw his pants off and was like, okay, I'm ready to go. Let's start this one.
Is that what you do? You just throw your trousers
on?
You get comfy mode?
I mean, everybody
has their own comfy mode. I mean, I've switched into comfy pants. I do. So it's like jogging bottoms.
There's no pants like no pants.
Well, okay. Yeah. I mean, that's a whole new level. But it is King's Row, so we're going to get to see how these guys work out, what they're going to do. Yeah. Of course, it is a setup tournament. They're going to be straight up attacking, defending. Unlike before, it's not about whether you get the payload there in time. It's just about whether you get the payload there or not.
Yeah. So this isn't stopwatch. This is, like you said, based off of finishing the map. If you don't finish the map, it comes down to distance, and that will decide who wins on that map in particular. But yeah, the new competitive mode, that's the format we're going through the entire way, I believe, of the qualifiers. However, coming to the main event, there is still potential for rules to be changed according to the feedback from the community and the players.
So let's have a look what the defensive setup is. It is going to be fairly standard from them. Mercy, Reinhardt in there from PKR and Weber. So that's going to be the defensive line. Of course, there's going to be a Reaper in there with a Lucio, a Pharah, and a Hog. Hog becoming very, very popular of late.
Yeah, he's got the one-shot mechanic that McCree had, basically. It wasn't one-shot. It was a fan of the hammer, then maybe a roll and a fan of the hammer again. But it's got similar similar opportunities. And when you run a Roadhog behind a Reinhardt, you have that shield. You're not going to take damage. You're not going to feed ultimate to the other team. And you get some quick picks if you can potentially pull it off. But Coin Flippers are switching up themselves. They go in for the Zarya. They go in for the Reinhardt to pair in with that. So looking to actually absorb some damage to the Zarya to actually allow them to push through. And they're running Kika here on the high ground with the Pharah paired up with Pair 2. If he can get in the right positions.
Been watching a lot of Tivik going up and around the side there, or Tivik, I should say, actually. We got to get the pronunciation correct on his name, but that was exactly the Pharah move he did. You got to keep in close around the hotel just in case there's any Widowmakers looking to pop you off. There's no, of course, on the opposite team. So jumping around the side there, trying to work down, but that Mercy getting very close, actually, just above them, and that's because a Reaper is there, and that is first blood, effectively, for the defensive team.
Never thought I'd really ever see a Reaper take a Pharah down 1v1 like that. I mean, you should always be in the high ground, and Pharah's really good against Reaper, and he's super plain smart. So if you guys are just learning on how to play a little bit and you're getting into competitive, once you pick up a couple of kills, you don't want to let the rest of the team escape. You want to rush them down with the help of your Lucio to speed amp you through. Pick up those kills, get some ult percent on your side, and then really punish them on spawn timers because you kind of separate and just join them all spawning back up together. But here we go. Ultimates are coming online. Aquarion Pharah does have the barrage. Weaver does have his Earth Shatter, which just went off. And now you're trying to see Akuri come in from the side to actually pull up some kills. And there he's looking for the Mercy. Weaver's already picked up quite a few kills himself, and that is going to be a wipe.
Yeah, that wasn't pretty. That wasn't pretty at all. The winner of this game will be going through to face Anox. So Anox are going to be sat ready and waiting for these. You obviously know the Anox team. Very much full of the Quake guys, the ex-Quake guys. In and around that. We'll see how they fare against them. But at the moment, this is looking very good for the defensive side already. They've got 2 minutes to hold this point. And honestly, it's looking like it's going to stay that way because as of yet, the attacking team yet to really make a dent on the control point.
Yeah, I mean, they do use the sand barrier here, but they've already lost their Mercy. So you're not really going to accomplish too much off the back of it. Luckily, Keek does actually pick up 2 kills. With his barrage and looking for that third onto the Reinhardt. So a decent start here so far. With PKR down, they don't have a revive on the defending side, which means they do have the potential to take this point.
Yeah, I feel like I gave them commentator's curse. they were holding strong, and then immediately Wattid comes in, gets himself a double with the tactical visor, and it is all cleanup duty. So Object is going to be underway, barring anything spectacular, which I don't believe is going to come through here. You can see, obviously, Mallow holding onto that ulti, Graviton Surge for a long time. So, control point captured. Let's see how they go with the payload.
My question is for Yasuba, and particularly, how are they going to defend this? Because now that they have the entire team coming back up, Aquarius is going to be joining them in just a few seconds. They're able to fight in this area. They're not actually giving this one up for free, which you see a lot of teams, a lot of the you know, the top tier teams, when they're on attack here, they take the payload, then they rush straight forward to hold them back and spawn. But Queen Flippers hasn't done that, which has allowed now Yasuba to get set up and get in the position they want to. As long as PKR can stay alive with his revive, then they should have a solid hold here.
Well, they're getting a little bit of flanking, so Tarkyu getting around there. That's actually backfired on them,
yep.
Because the flank backfired. It puts them immediately in a 5v6 situation, which gives them quick advantage to try and push around that corner. Of course,
they should shove this.
Stick with the payload, trying to shove it as much as they can. They are working that shield down. There we go. That's going to be the Reinhardt shield drop. They're going to get the Graviton Surge. Completely whiffed, though. It didn't catch anybody in that ulti, and that's a big, long charge on the ulti. There's the Resurrect coming through, but I don't think it's going to help them end at all. You can see the Soldier. He has his eyes trained on that Pharah. Should get picked down in a minute. Went with a double reload after using about 2 shots there. Tactical visor used. And he should just keep them away. I think it's going to be the first point caught out, no problem.
That was a major mistake by Coin Flippers, and yet they still kind of somehow won off the back of that because they charged through. And like you said, the Graviton Surge missed, but they didn't catch out PKR, which is the big key. That Earth Shatter is going to be missing. Unfortunately, Janowon's not going to connect, and the charge will land, though. And we'll take at least one man down with him, which eventually should be picked up. But they're still skirmishing over this point. It hasn't been captured just yet.
Yeah, the Reinhardt, of all people, delaying them, putting around that point. Lucio just going to try and jump around as much as he can. Picked off eventually. That's going to be the payload reaching the final phase. So, 5 minutes to get this payload in and around the corner. There is a good choke point, but honestly, at the start, I felt like it was going to be easy for Yasuba. They seem to have this one in the bag. But Coin Flippers, since they finally got that capture point at the start, they've just not really slowed down. And that's down to Tarkyu obviously making that big mistake on the Reaper. Switched across to Soldier, now switched across to Widowmaker. They don't feel comfortable, obviously, on what they can hold on.
Yeah, the snowball effect is real. And I bet you all there playing competitive are feeling it as well. Oh, the charge!
He
got it,
so
but
close.
He died in his hands because of the Pharah Barrage. So it works out for him in the end. He's still towards the backside, takes on Azaria. They have no revive left available here. And Weaver, basically by himself, is going to be able to pick up these kills and hold them back.
And manages to pick off 2 more as well. But that payload's still being contested. Just one man hanging around there. Pharah trying to cause as much problems as he picks off the Widowmaker on the side there. Tarkyu does go down. PKR, as you mentioned, neither of them had a revive at the time, but now we have Sound Barrier and Resurrect available for the defensive team. So probably going to be a tough push here if they're going to try it. Of course, we do look around the ultis. We do have Barrage ready and waiting to go. Let's see, because this Pharah has been doing some good work so far.
Widow, you got to hit Tarkyu. You got to hit these shots. You even have your Infrasight available. He's going to be able to use it now, but the Graviton Surge came through, pulled them all together, and the hook comes in. That might have just saved his entire team because the Barrage was there and ready. Actually, no, it wasn't there and ready. I'm making a mistake. It was there and ready.
It was.
I'm looking at the wrong ferret.
It totally was there. Yeah, this is working out well. That's a great attack. And, well, despite the fact, I think they focused a little too much on that Pharah pushing around the side because, as we can see, Tactical Visor ready and waiting. Payload's going to push on through, and that is going to be round one completed by the Coin Flippers in a pretty decent time. But as we mentioned, times don't really matter. It's all about can you complete the map, and King's Row has been completed by Coin Flippers despite the really good hold from Isuba. They held for about 3 or 4 minutes at the start, but once it fell, it was just non-stop. They just kept on pushing. I felt they could have held it there. They had the sound barrier, they had the resurrect, they had just about everything ready and waiting to go.
Yeah, and now Isuba are going to be on the attack. Even though they're on the blue side, they're still going to be attacking here. That's with the new update of the new competitive mode plus spectating client. Just if you guys are wondering. But yeah, so Isuba, a little bit of snowball went against them. I didn't agree necessarily with Tarku playing the Widowmaker there at the end. He didn't accomplish much, and he used his Infrasight too late. He used it way too late, because he could have saw them coming in and picked off Kick before he actually had a chance to really get any kills and even get around towards the back. Luckily, that hook came through and saved him a little bit of time, but like you just said, time is not going to matter here. So, to kind of take stock of things, if Isuba do finish, it'll be a tie. Both teams get 1 point each. The only way we'll go to a King of the Hill tiebreaker is if it's tied after the series.
We'll see how it works out for them. Of course, not to be confused, blue is attacking this time. It is the change.
Yeah, we're going to enjoy that as casters, I think.
Yeah, I know. It threw me off, and I was like, wait, that should be... Turkey was definitely on defense. And I was like, wait, but they are on the attacking staging point. Yes, obviously it was a change that happened recently in the competitive mode. That's what we're obviously using here. So, let's see how it works out for them. On the defensive side, let's spin across to theirs, actually. Actually, it's good for me as a spectator because it keeps the numbers the same.
True. That is true. Actually, you remember it once, and you're good to go.
Yeah. So we're just going to remember them, that's all. But as you can see, Reinhardt, Pharah, Hog, Mercy, Lucio, and Soldier 76. Exactly the same defensive lineup, actually. So we'll see whether it works out for them. The Coin Flippers this time on the defense.
Okay, so this is definitely going to mess with me for quite a long time here. But with the Winston, they're looking to actually jump straight in onto this point, and Akuri's already connecting quite a few shots. He misses a relatively easy shot, but takes Kiki down. That gives him the height advantage here, and this makes things even more difficult for Coin Flippers to hold.
Getting boosted and healed up around the side as well, and now it's got the flank now. This is going to be very hard for them to hold already. Isuba pushing very hard on the Coin Flippers, and the fact that Pharah went down so early on, it just gave them all of that high ground around the side, and that was a very easy cap there. Control point, all theirs, payload in motion. And this is what you were talking about.
Yeah, the push,
the aggressive push to keep them back.
Because they're going to be spawned in the tunnels. They're going to have a really bad spawn from this position. And if you can pick up the kills, you force them all the way back to their own initial or ending spawn, which means they have to run even further. It gives you so much more control of the area. But they didn't really push together as a team. So they actually did concede some ground to Coin Flippers here.
Yeah, they didn't get a kill either. Like you say, they didn't push around. They normally get the Reinhardt around there, the soldiers work them down as soon as they come out of those tunnels. Because it's a very easy, you know, effectively when you know when they're coming from that spawn point. But there you go, Barrage ready and waiting to go. And this is the counter side for the Coin Flippers, because they just didn't get any hold, didn't build up those ulties much, other than they've got the resurrect.
Yeah.
They're really going to struggle to hold this.
Yeah, they do have the res though, so both Mercies will have that available, which can easily turn the tide of a fight for you, and there's not really too much up off the back of that, except Akuri with his barrage. But Tarku's about to have his Death Blossom available. And I think they're looking for that push in. If Dafsa can maybe get his Graviton Surge online, this is going to be a relatively easy take. But Tarku, he's got behind him. And this is where it gets dangerous.
Here comes the flank. Death Blossom ready to go. Die. Hits a max with Barrage. Beautifully executed. Gets themselves, what, 4 kills there? Think almost the team wipe, barring just the one single Fat Man. But he's all the way back at spawn, so he must have died at the start. It was a team ace. Beautifully, beautifully done.
See, I like that they use the ultimates to pick up the kills, but I don't agree with Akiri to actually use his barrage there, because you had Tarku pick up 3 kills. He killed the Mercy. So it's like, Mercy's dead. There's no revive. You don't need to throw any more ultimates that you don't necessarily need to, and now he's not going to be paired with Dafsa to pull off the Graviton Surge barrage combo. So if you look at the long run, yeah, it's a little bit of nitpicking, and I probably shouldn't do that. But if you're playing against one of the top teams, which will be happening later on today or tomorrow, you can't really let those mistakes go.
When you can't let those mistakes happen either, this Pharah is doing work. Oh, he missed the easy shot, actually. Landed the 2 hard shots and then missed the mid-air easy shot. Either way, Graviton Surge goes down. There goes the rockets. That's going to be the damage done. And at the moment, it looks like it's going to be quick and easy on King's Row. For both teams, of course, this doesn't mean either team's going to win. It's not times. It is all about completing the map, and it's looking like it's very much going to be possible here by the attacking team. But they've been held for now. Mm-hmm. You can see Watch Duco on the Lucio here. Has got Soundbar. He just managed to pick one off.
He booped him off.
Yeah.
He killed Mala there somehow. And that actually is, it's not amazing for them because they're not going to attack off the back of that, but it's a nice little BM kill for him.
It's the fact that he managed to get out. Ordinarily, you'd see them just suicide, just jump off the edge there just so they can respawn back with the team, but instead he's literally got a kill and backed out. Nicely done.
Okay, so they do have the Barrage, they do have the Revive, they don't have much to combo yet, but Weaver, is that 90% of their Shatter? He's using it one swing off or just wait a couple of seconds, and I'll have it available. So if now, Coin Flippers group up, they're going to be in a world of pain. They have to be careful, they have to spread out. They have no real high ground advantage because Kiki keeps dying in that 1v1 battle up against Aquiri.
Well, look at this. Barrage ready and waiting to go. Tark's got it ready to go as well. That's going to be the kill on the Mercy. There's going to be the Soldier 76 going down. Graviton Surge was used defensively, but it's not really working out. That's going to be a mid-air shot. This Pharah are doing some serious work here, Query, and that may well be game. They're going to keep one last man away. The Fat Man comes in to try and keep them off. The Roadhog not able to hold them back, and that will be the map going even between the two teams, Isuba and Coin Flippers both ending it. Now, if we were sticking on times, actually, I think times were pretty close as well because they got delayed a little bit there where Coin Flippers were slow to capture out the initial point, but eventually managed to get in there. We're back in to the lobby. So, who chooses the map?
Losers.
But then there's no losers.
So I think it goes... God, you just had to ask me that. I think it just goes to the standard... I don't think anyone knows. I'm assuming it's the higher seed chooses. Then in that case,
yeah. Okay, we're gonna say.
But I'm gonna confirm.
Yeah. Okay. I believe. Just checking. I mean, technically, it'd be the lower seed because the loser chooses. Can't speak. It's been a long day for me.
It has been. You flew in from England today.
I've been on the road since 6 a.m. So
I wish the camera could see what we have over in that corner, though.
I'm a full 12 hours in, and we've got about 6 hours to go. So this could be a bit of a weird word. Mash for me. That's exactly
like it
where it's going.
Okay, we have an admin responding. I want supposed to do.
It's good.
I feel bad that we don't know this, but I actually didn't really expect it to happen too much. But we'll see. Okay, apparently admin's not even sure, I'm guessing. I don't know. Anyways, but the next map will be chosen, like you said, and we still have Dorado, Hollywood, Hanamura, Nepal, and Gibraltar to be chosen from.
Yeah,
so my question
is
coming into, are we going to see any of the capture point maps picked up? Any of the assault maps? Because that's the mode that's been changed the most.
Yeah, Hanamura, where we can get that in there. That's going to be the big change. I'm intrigued to see where Anox go with this as well, because obviously they've been heavily favoring the King of the Hill style maps over the Go Fours.
Coin flip will determine the next. Okay, so do you have a coin on you? I don't know.
I don't have any coins on me. I empty my pockets before I come in here. I can flip my phone. I don't want to do that, though.
No. Break. Do it, please.
Might break. Don't want to do that. None of us have coins on us. There is a coin flip mob.
Okay, so tell...
Coin flip.
Tell Isuba to choose heads
Isuba
or tails.
Isuba, heads or tails. This, ladies and gentlemen, is esports.
It happens.
It does, actually.
It's a work in progress.
Do you remember... Apollo actually cast the coin flip tournament for DreamHack. One of the StarCraft...
Wait, was it the Rock, Paper, Scissors, or was
StarCraft
it the coin flip?
One of the two games got decided on a coin flip, I believe.
And they picked tails.
Then as a fun side, they actually did.
Heads.
All the StarCraft players, it said.
Sorry.
Okay.
So that means coin flippers. Funny enough, we probably should get then the flip. Get to choose map.
Irony. Choose map.
Okay. All right, then. So yeah, he casted the coin flip.
Yeah, so all the StarCraft guys that were at DreamHack, because the previous DreamHack was decided on a coin flip, not the whole tournament, obviously, but one of the ties was, as a part of fun, all the StarCraft players took part in literally a coin flip tournament.
which is
such a weird thing to... he's going for heads,
It's serious. You've got to think about strategically, right?
Tails.
It's been heads three times in a row, so what does that mean?
Oh, it is going
to
be Hanamura.
It's a 50-50 chance for it to be tails anyways. Okay, so Hanamura...
Yep.
No. They are asking if the team that wins this map wins the whole series. No, because there's still a third map.
Still 0-0.
No, or 1-1. Yeah.
1-1. It's maps, not points. Yeah. 1-1 is correct. Okay. Try to explain the rules to them as they go. I mean, we get it. They're not pro teams, and sometimes we do need to share our knowledge with these guys. Go. Okay, we're readying them up. They're ready to go, boys. I mean, I know you love staring at my lovely face. It's been on air quite a lot over the last week. So hopefully they'll be ready to go. I can see Hanamura loading. This is brilliant. Okay. So it's going to be Hanamura.
We'll drop in.
We're going to drop straight in. Good stuff. Let's get in there. Let's check out the beautiful map. Obviously, Hanamura, it is all about capturing point A and moving on and capturing point two. Actually, probably, I would say my favorite capture point map, I think. I really enjoy this one. You can also get a crazy, crazy snowball, as you can on quite a few of the capture point maps. If you catch them out, you can pile straight up there. And that's what I'm expecting. I'm thinking
winner of this does win, by the way.
The winner of this does win.
Winner of this does win, if you want to let them know. I had to confirm with admins just to double check. Winner of this map will win because it's first to 2 points because it's a best of three. Even though I'm kind of in the same understanding as you.
I'm not sure about this.
Yeah.
That seems a bit weird.
Because I feel like if it's points, then they have a chance to come back at the third map, right?
Yeah, no, yeah. Because it goes to a third map regardless. It has to, because it's 1-1. I totally disagree with what he's saying there. It's because it's...
Whatever, we'll check with the admins.
With admin after...
We'll check with admins in the meantime.
Oh, I missed the good luck. Good luck, have fun, smiley winky. Okay, let's have a look. While you sort that out, I'm going to look towards it because we've got 15 seconds to go and the defensive side is setting up. Let's have a look what we got. Wotted is going to be on Soldier 76, one of my current faves at the moment. And May is Bay. I absolutely love playing May, and May is quite trolley on this map, can work out very well. We've got a Roadhog in there on Kikiri. He played it in the... Actually played Farah in the previous map. Mala playing on... Zaya once again plays Zaya in the previous map. Kop'Won also going to be playing on Lucio and Perto. But this is a quick attack straight away. The double Winston's coming in. Of course, no hero limits in this tournament. The double Winston's on site, but unfortunately for them, it is not working out too well.
All right, so I mean, the May, it's going to, like you said, it's going to buy a little bit of time here, but not really accomplished too much. The wall actually perfectly placed because they're all trying to come in from the same direction. He's feeding over Zarya charge, though. But because they have the man advantage, they're more than comfortable to do that and then pick up the kills. And they will successfully repel. So guys, it's the time bank system. It's a little bit different than what you're used to. And we'll explain it further as the game obviously does go on. But it revolves around the fact of whatever time you have left when you finish the map is the time you have left into the next round if you have to go again if both teams complete.
Yes.
That's a quick, easy way about it.
If you played your placement matches, and good luck with those, and then you will have... come across this setup. That is exactly what you've been having in competitive. All that Reinhardt showing his back a little too much there. Weber, of course, the man that came straight from work, gets freezes up pretty quickly and taken down. Now, the rest of his team didn't come in at the same time around the corner, which instantly put that poor old Reinhardt in a pretty precarious situation.
And what did he's just spraying with this whole clip. I mean, typically on Soldier, if you're sparing long range, right, you want to do four bullet bursts because you want to be able to hit the heads and not have your recoil spread. But for the most part, he's spraying a good portion of this one. And yeah, it's not a big deal when you're spraying against a Reinhardt because you want to take the shield down. And with a nice use of the tactical visor, you're just going to be able to force them back. He's only going to get like one kill or stun to one kill, maybe two. What's up?
You gotta love tactical visor. Like, he was aiming at the tracer, spat around, and killed Reinhardt. It was like, I didn't even know he was there.
he doesn't have to pay for it.
It's just like,
free.
Oh, didn't even see that guy. Thanks for the kill. But yeah, the tactical visor used for the offensive team, that was Tarku, and I think it's going to work out for them. They will finally capture this point out. So they held onto those ultis as long as they could. And, well, the only person left is going to be Main. Got the ulti ready, but it's a big ulti. It can work well, but you've got to be careful you don't get caught in snowball. Coin the punt into the corner there. Maybe snowball.
Yeah, so now they have 7 minutes and 40 seconds left to capture this point. And let's just say they finish it in about 2 minutes and 38 seconds. That means they have 5 minutes of time to work with in their bank for the next round. Oh, this is going to be perfect. Milo's in the great position. Use that Graviton Surge to catch him off guard. PKR just has to not be caught out, but they're still in the position to pull this off. They just haven't gone for it just yet, and PKR is actually peeking out a little bit too dangerously.
Yeah, and going to get caught out nicely. That Mercy working well. Got himself hidden away around the side. The ulti from May. Oh, that's the disaster. Didn't catch too much there. Didn't really work out for them. In comes the Rhino. It's got Earth Shatter ready and waiting to go. The Mercy is just around the side as well. They're going to be pushing in. There's the Earth Shatter. There's the pin catching down Cop 1. That's a disaster for them. If he can catch on to the Mercy as well, he's in desperate trouble. Good shield coming out there from the side. Does manage to catch him out. That's a great Graviton Surge as well. Is it going to be enough, though? He's blocking out a lot of the damage. They're still not managing to take them down. Let's spin across to the May. May's trying desperately to freeze out. This Reinhardt will catch him down in the back there, and they do just about defend. Good wall as well there. Usage to pin off the side, but that was very close to being a quick cap.
And you have to be really dangerous of that, too, because of the way the time bank system works. You want to be able to successfully repel that first attack. Typically, the team will have a lot more ultimates up against you than you will. But they've conceded a lot of the high ground, allowing Nakiri to push in towards this right side to get up towards that top area. You know, Mala before, he got taken down before he really had much of a chance. But with four ultimates online, three Suba, they're going to go for the push in. Weaver doesn't have his just yet, unfortunately. And Nakiri coming in from the perfect position. You should have gone for it. That was a great opportunity, dear. And he fluffs it.
No, absolutely whiffed it horribly there. As you said, that was perfect. It looks so good. Well, Soldier 76 does get the one kill, but that's all he's going to get. That sound barrier is going to prevent him getting any more. The rest of his team picked off around the side there as well.
Turret.
So it really hasn't worked very well. And as you mentioned, just got picked off and dealt with. That did not go so well. But Davsa still around the side. Does have his Graviton Surge available. May trying to sneak around the backside. The wall trolling them quite convincingly. It's actually kept them pinned, so they're separated from the rest of the team at the moment.
And also, not to mention, they've lost quite a few people on the initial push because, like I said, the way they have been kind of split up. And the fact that they're keeping them here is just making it even more difficult for them to have any sort of chance to actually push through. You can take down your wall, but you won't have an opportunity to actually get a kill, and he will fall to Tarku.
Strange ulti usage around there. I was thinking, okay, who's he caught? But didn't catch anyone. Now we've got a Torbjorn switch out here. He's got Molten Core ready to go, and he's setting it up in the entrance. As soon as it's his level two, he could hit that Molten Core, and away we go. There we go. And is it going to be enough? Because there's going to be free damage from the sides, and that's what they're hoping for. The question is, can he get in and out?
Kill Mercy.
Switch across. Maybe he will. This is going to be easy damage from behind. The Reinhardt, they're not too sure where this damage is coming from. And as you say, kill the goddamn Mercy. It's not working out for them. They're trying to hold the point.
That focus was utter trash, not gonna lie. We'll get back to it in a second, though, as the revive is gonna be coming through on the defensive and the actually the offensive side didn't get to use it. PKR somehow got picked off here, and this should be coin flippers holding, but Query coming at the barrage, picks up two kills. The turret's finally gonna go down, and they finally have enough men here to defend this point.
Well, they're gonna might be aim cap it out. It's gonna be Torbjorn, just gotta keep them away. They're gonna hit that first marker. Is it gonna be enough? They may even get on the second marker. The respawn's coming out. Mercy comes leaping around. Mercy even pew-pewing as he comes around the corner with the Lucio. They do hit the second marker. Now they might just need to finish it off. I'm not sure they've got it in the bag to finish this off right now, but they're gonna hit that second marker, which is the main important part.
Well, if they can keep picking them off, if they keep staggering their spawns a little bit, they're definitely gonna have the chance. It's still being contested. Mercy's trying to be focused on. PKR has revive available. He should literally just be hiding right now. Wait for the revive to come through to pull this off. But luckily for him, coin flippers don't have any big ultimates or any ultimates up at this moment.
Yeah, the fact that they use that Torbjorn ulti early on there, you can see the defensive work going through. May's going to try and get around the side there. Soldier 76 got his ulti going once again. He's been on this site for so long, untouched. He should be able to take this Mercy down. Are they going to be clearing the site? The Zerg is just not enough. I think they've done it. I think they've managed to cap it out there. Finally, Hanamura. No! No! The respawn of Reaper gets back in.
Reaper and Lucio together. They're buying some time. Mala and Pertu going to be coming through. Remember, they can spam heroes. There is no hero limit. But still, even though Coin Flippers did lose a second point, they took off a good 6.5 minutes of time, which is amazing considering how quickly they could have lost that point with that initial attack. So honestly, a good job nonetheless. And now it comes down to this. Isuba, they're going to need to finish
quick. They've got 3 minutes 35 in the time bank. You can see it on the top right there. So they're going to have to be, as you say, pretty damn quick. We'll see how it works out for them.
Sorry, well, I guess Coin Flipper is the one that needs to actually
coin
finish quickly.
Do, yes, yes.
Just so you have a time advantage here. But
you're getting thrown by the red and blue, aren't you?
Yeah, it's really throwing me off. It's really hard to get used to.
When you've cast it for as long as you have throughout the beta, it's then they switch it on you.
It's nice, though. It makes my life easier for graphics.
It makes graphics a whole lot simpler. It makes the spectating a whole lot simpler because I don't need to switch the points of view, etc.
Now, but if only we could do like the two DPSs are 1 and 2, the supports are 6s, the tanks are 5.
The dream.
Like, yeah,
the
dream. Then you know where to go easily,
but
right?
How do you keep the DPS? Because technically you could have 6 DPSs.
Well, because they'd be. Well, I mean, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It doesn't work that way.
Don't poke holes in this.
I'm happy as it is. It's a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or if you guys at home probably using the F keys, but we switch it to the 1 to 6 and then shift 1 to 6. But there you go, the life of casting and the life of specking. But we are having a slightly different defensive setup here. A Widowmaker being used, not sold on that. They have got the Symmetra. Symmetra can work. Pharah in defense as well, along with the Roadhog, and then the standard Mercy Reinhardt.
It's not the Widow I disagree with. It's Tarku playing Widow. No offense to him. Just because on King's Row, he didn't really hit much. I mean, he had a couple of shots,
switched out very quick.
I don't think he got many kills. Yeah. So this is. I mean, if you have someone like, you know, Lynx are playing Sniper Row too easy, then hell yeah, like they'll be able to hold this down and hit the shots. I'm not 100% convinced by Tarku just yet, but luckily for him, he has an opportunity here to prove me wrong.
Well, he's chose to go aggressive, peeking in the window. Unfortunately for him, they're all going left. They're all going left. They're all going to be around the right side. I'm going to switch to Genji to see where he goes. He's going to be jumping straight through. He's going to be looking for them. Passes the Symmetra turrets, no problem. Gets himself the full heal and gets the flank around. Spots out that there is going to be a Widowmaker nearby. Blocks all the damage and gets the kill on Tarku. He does get picked off, though, by Akuri just around the side. Is it enough to hold the point? It looks like it's not.
We'll see, though. I mean, actually, I haven't been able to defend it. I guess the red threw off.
The red threw me off.
Don't worry, it did to me, too. Easy thing is, look at the top. And look which one's actually lit, the red or the blue.
Yeah.
That's how I'm doing it. But no, they hold on. Akuri, again, he wasn't dealt with.
They got the first marker in, though.
Yeah. Yeah, they did.
Which is massive for the first attack, I guess. We'll see how it sticks out.
But because the defensive side won, they should have these ultimates up a lot quicker. I mean, Query's at 70%. PKR is already at ultimate up. And Wada needs to take down some of these turrets. It needs someone to deal with them. It looks like it's going to be in D.Va's hands. And there's the revive being used out of Isu, but just to maintain this point.
Well, it's going to be the Mercy ult. He's getting good tags down here. Tracer just going to keep them taking. Oh, that didn't really work out. That was a pretty big whiff on the Reinhardt ult. A neutron bomb going down as well, catching out. That's going to be the Pharah trying to get the ulti off. And this has gone horribly wrong. Watson's picking up kill after kill after kill. And while this is all happening, okay, teleport has just been placed down. We'll keep an eye on that one. Mercy comes diving back into sight. Watson's still untouched on this Tracer. Absolutely doing some serious, serious work. Getting kill after kill after kill. And at the moment, they just can't seem to deal with him.
But that teleporter's in. It's actually allowed them to get back in towards this push. And Kiki using the Roadhog ultimate against him. And a whole hog to knock him off the point, and that will sufficiently pick up the kill. But Akuri, isn't he still alive? Is he still not being dealt with on point?
The res on point! Look at that, they're about to cap it out. They've managed to get the Mercy res in just in time. Is it going to be enough? I don't think it will be. Weaver gets taken down, that's the Reinhardt dropped. There's going to be the final nail in the coffin, and one just little clearance. Okay, he's been bullied off site. Now they're going to try and push it. Look how quick they can go. Is it going to be enough? I don't think that. There should be set up on site, but are we going to see Symmetra switch? I'm not sure. He seems to be sticking.
He should be switching. There's no real reason. Yeah, he's looking for... He's trying to find the Lucio, I guess.
Took a long time to decide.
Yeah, he did. And Akuri, well, he's gone down to... Tarku again, sticking on Widowmaker hasn't been too effective. He does have his ultimate up, which means they have the extra vision, but he switches away, so they're going to lose that. Then it comes down to his Reaper coming in to be able to hold this point. But they're already going to be losing PKR.
Yeah, that's the Mercy down. I'll see if we can get anything else. He's looking for the Lucio as well. Oh, he's got that down as well, and the Reaper can't pick him off. He's got his ultimate available. Dragon Blade goes out. He gets himself one and two and make that three. This may well be a very quick time bank set up here. This is working out wonderfully.
PKR's got revive.
They haven't just dealt with Genji. They didn't deal with the Tracer. They just seem to struggle with the team comp.
It's not over, though, because they got the revive out of PKR to get his entire team back alive. They have the two tanks. They have the Reaper. They have ultimates, too, to push them off the point. And I think Isuba have actually held on for a little bit longer because coin flippers are losing too many people. Even Pertu doesn't have revive up just yet.
They finally got the Genji down on the Tracer, so they managed to clear out the site. But first marker was hit. As you can see, that's going to reset down. But it was a good start for them, absolutely. And you can see the time, 6:42. They've got 3:35 in the bank for Isuba. The question is, can they get more coin flippers? Seems to be working out well, but they're lacking on the ultis this time around. They had pretty much everything stacked up ready to go in that last fight.
They don't really have much siege potential either. You have Shurikens out of a Genji. You have Tracer and D.Va, whose damage really falls off long range. And then Janna went with a Fire Strike every once in a while here, which he will connect. He will have her shutter up. He's going to be looking to come in from behind them here towards the top side to actually use this Earth Shower to give them some sort of an opportunity to push through. There it is, two people being knocked down and some kills finally coming through. But PKR, he's going to have his revive up in just a few seconds. I'm not going to give him the win on this just yet. The charge is going to miss, unfortunately, at Janowon, and the heals is still there. PKR has been taken down, though.
And we're going to see the Genji ulti in a minute. That Lucio is not looking long for this world. Oh, he actually missed it. Missed the shot. He dived in on him. He does finally get him picked off there. And this could well be the point. Who knows? Looking like they're going to keep them in the spawn. Reaper's going to be out of the Wraith form through, but does have his ultimate available. Can he get it off? No. Picked off instantly the second he tries to pop that Death Blossom. There's the revive, but it's not going to be quite enough. You're going to see them contesting the site. We can see the second marker already hit. 5 minutes 30 remaining in the time bank. Should they close out the game just now? Here comes the monkey.
They're not going to close it out here.
No, they're not going to close it out.
They shouldn't really be able to. PKR, he got a good revive off again to actually keep them back in the fight. A lot of people are actually still running back towards the actual spawn here. And Reaper got another ultimate back off and online. But Mali's trying to get his mech suit back out. But he's super. They're just buying time. This is exactly what we saw Coin Flippers do on the defense in this last half.
Don't discount this bunny gun. It is absolutely deadly. And there is his suit. Got back into it. The rest of his team are going to come in there. Should be able to get himself back up onto the site. The Tracer's coming around. There's going to be the Winston as well. It's working well for them. Finally, starting to clear out the site. The Lucio. But the problem is, because they're killing them one by one, they've got that Zerg momentum now that they can just keep on contesting the site, even if they're not getting the kills. That's going to block out the left-hand side. The right-hand side is cocked off. There we go. 4:43. So almost a minute ahead of them. It's just over a minute ahead of them on the time bank. Now, you guys at home, if you've been playing competitive, because it's a draw, we go into the time bank mode, and you can see it's about how quickly they closed it off.
Yeah, so now we have Isuba on the attack with only 3.5 minutes to work with. And they'll try to get as far as they can. Then Coin Flippers are going to have to match that with their 4 minutes and 43 seconds. So, I mean, if you still look at how that last kind of attack went, it could have gone heavily in favor of Coin Flippers just with the way that they got the initial attacks off, right? Like, they were looking so damn good to take the point in, like, 6 minutes of time left. But Isuba just dragged it out as long as they could, try to even up the times. It's not necessarily about full holding the final point. Maybe if you're competitive, you're more worried about that. As long as they can just take as much time as they possibly can away.
That was me this morning.
In a space suit?
Yeah, you know.
Noodles and...
London's a bit different to Europe, because we're not in it anymore.
Well, yeah, it's not in it. I was going to say.
A little homage to StarCraft, which is actually going on right now. The Meisterschaft. StarCraft.
So let's...
Todd and Kalaris over there. But defensive setup. Yeah. Okay, a bit different this time around. A Genji... Oh, wait.
Coin Flippers are defending.
Coin Flippers are defending. They're using a Genji defense.
Yep.
Okay.
So, well, I mean, Davso, he's playing the flex role for Isuba. He's going to be switching over to a Genji 2, it looks like. So Genji versus Genji battle, but also they don't have anyone necessarily to deal with Aquiri, who's been flying around on Fair for the most part, doing, honestly, a lot of work across this map and King's Row. They don't really have a response to him, so it comes up to Kiki pretty much by himself to deal with them, which is a tall task alone as a Genji, but also have to worry about an opposing Genji at the same time. It's going to be really difficult to deal with this.
Weaver lining himself up, ready to leap on into the site. Here we go. Let's see if he can get it going. That's a brilliant start, picking off both supports. That is just about the disaster for Coin Flippers. I don't think it's going to work out very well for them. Weaver will get frozen up, but not really going to do a great deal against it if they can clear off the site. It's going to take them a little bit of doing, but they may well cap this out very fast.
It seems like the focus has been a little bit wonky out of both teams. A lot of Mercies are surviving a hell of a lot longer than they actually should, especially when they're in the middle of the team during the fight. But they're going to get the point, like you said. Very, very quick time for them. And they're looking to capture second point. So now at a minimum, Coin Flippers are going to have to capture that first point with their 4 minutes and 40 seconds left.
And you can see ulti's built up fairly well. The query just going to keep on picking around the side. Oof, took a big chunk of damage though, but took down the turret.
I'm surprised to actually not see them use the Torbjorn. It's not a glitch, it's just the weapon switching that you can do. You can make his turrets build extremely quickly and repair extremely quickly, which makes it hard for Fair to be able to deal with them. Gonna have to worry about your own health a little bit more, but we're seeing the attack finally come in. They're finally on the point again. Mercy, what are you doing? You cannot be in that position. He's gonna be taken out extremely quickly, and they might as well just cap the point here.
That's a disaster. That is an absolute disaster. May's not gonna be able to keep them at bay here. He's the
only jump in there.
Alive.
You gotta knock him away from the point.
Just gotta contest it. Just gotta do anything. Just gotta try and hold anything away, but that is it. They're going to get the respawn around, but they've already got the second marker. They've just got 1 minute to close this out, and that isn't going to be a problem when Davso gets his ulti off like that. Just clearing out the point. Contested just by the Tracer spam, but it's not going to be enough to keep them up at bay. That was pretty easy for Isuba there. They didn't really get held up on the first point. And then the second point, as you mentioned, what are you doing? You just can't leave yourself hanging.
I mean,
right in front of the team, dangling as a mercy.
I don't want to be too harsh on them, because sometimes you try to fly to someone and then they move and then you get stuck where they were, and that's when the enemy team pushes on it. You have to like think ahead of time, right? Yeah. If you want to dash to someone, you're like a second and a half away.
Or you're flying to get killed or something.
Yeah, you have to assume that in a second and a half, the other team's not going to be there. It's a little bit hard to do, but again, if you want to be able to beat the best teams and you want to be playing at Gamescom in August, you have to kind of make those mistakes not happen, at least not as much, or hopefully for you not get punished as much. That looks like a Naruto jacket, I swear.
It's possible.
There's an homage to in Li Zheng Tower, if you haven't seen that yet. On one of the suits, they have a name of a person who was a big Overwatch fan in China, and he was chasing someone down that stole a lady's purse, a thief, and he died, actually, while chasing him down. So they actually put a little bit of homage to him to, you know, give him a little bit of...
It's a bit of a sad story. Thanks.
Yeah, it's a little bit sad, but it's cool to see Overwatch are paying attention to their community, you know, Blizzard. Mm. Paying attention to who's doing good things in their community.
Well, how are they going to adapt? Not too sure. Firstly, we're not going to have a Widowmaker on defense this time. The query is going to be sitting on the Pharah once
again.
Thank
God Tarku's not doing it this time.
Tarku's staying on Soldier again this time. Yeah, he's not not going for that Widowmaker.
I mean, again, I don't want to be too harsh on these players, because these are teams we typically don't see too often. But like, if you're going to play a Widowmaker, especially after her nerf, you need to be confident in your aim.
He's
just going to get a Fire Strike
off.
He's
going to get the Fire Strike straight through. It's actually going to catch him as well.
Now.
Yep. Catches them. Yep.
Nope.
Did no damage. Yeah.
Looks like they dodge away from it, or maybe hit the door. Either way, he's going to be able to have that shield in the front line. They have the Symmetra, which isn't going to work out unless they can full hold this first point on that first attack.
I'm going to follow Watu, because he did a lot of damage last time around. The Symmetra taking a hell of a lot of beating already. Those turrets not really doing a great deal. The Pharah is getting picked off as well, and he's going to be picked through the air. This is a good attack. So both these teams working well at the start. But the question is, has he going to have the support? It doesn't look like it. So Watu's had to back away from this one. Two of his team got picked off there. Kiki just trying to stick around the side. Not going to be enough. The rest of his team needs to regroup.
Still pretty amazing that they held that when Watu was just so far in the back. He's still there technically right now. I think he's waiting for the teleport to come online. And Watuka has to be careful of where he actually plays. He's trying to assassinate this Mercy, which is going to be Zarya. Shield him. There you go. I was going to say, dear Lord, you just shield your Mercy and he's going to stay alive. And he's still actually fighting this one. He misses the Pulse Bomb, but Kiki's been able to charge through with him to be that two-man team.
Completely whiffed there, though. And that's the Symmetra getting the kill around the back. But he did manage to get the Mercy down. Now, is that ball enough time for the rest of his team to get in on sight? They were focusing so heavily on the Mercy that they completely pulled away from this one. And it looks like they will lose out the point. Soldier 76 trying to mad dash away from this target. Has got his ultimate, but not going to be able to use it. And that was pretty quick. It wasn't quite as quick as Isuma did it, but it might be enough.
And they had a minute extra time anyways.
Exactly. They do have that extra minute. Now 3 minutes to push on site with ultis available for the Mercy.
Nala just needs his Graviton Surge too. And Kiki, he used his Dragon Blade in that last fight to actually secure it for them. Genoa's using his whole hog to push them back, push them off the point. They're starting to finally get some progress on it, looking for that first checkpoint. They're going to get it. The hook comes in on the Mercy, and the Mercy gets the res off, but she's going to go down.
Well, did the job, did just about what she could. Gets pinned out there. Earthshatter forces the hog out of the fight, but Watt is still doing damage around the side there. This Lucio trying his best, but there's the Graviton Surge we were talking about. A neutral bomb stacked up on top of it. All beautifully, beautifully executed, and that will be a very quick time this time around from the coin flippers.
Okay, so my question is, could we see something like Counter-Strike where we have like, we're in a 32-32 for both teams?
2 minutes constantly.
It resets to 2 minutes whenever you whenever you finish under 2 minutes.
But, I mean, outside of coin flippers, eSuper didn't do it within 2 minutes. They were outside of
Let's just assume they can for once.
I mean,
could we see like 30, like 30
tennis,
for 30?
The tennis yesterday, I know I saw Tsonga went to 18-17 or something like that. 19-17, it closed out after doing four sets.
That'd be insane if that could happen. That'd be actually really cool to see. But yeah, so now we'll have eSuper on the attack and coin flippers on the defense. So 2 minutes, like you said, is the time they have to hold on to.
Bastion.
Bastion's not bad. The fact they don't have a solid frontline tank is Zarya isn't really a formidable force when it comes to like walking in. They're like, oh, it's a Zarya. Okay, we'll just not hit her and walk past her and she won't do any damage. I feel like a Reinhardt would be more imposing in this choke point, which forced them to sit back and actually attack the shield before just walking through. So what did I would imagine is going to get overrun extremely quickly if they're not careful, especially with the query in the air, with Dapsa off Genji. Okay. I like Bastion, but I don't like the way they're using him at the moment.
Yeah, he's trying to decide on a point. I think if he was setting up on the side there, he would have needed May in there. But now he's going to set up in the corner where May is. Kind of works for them. We'll see how well it goes. But they're going to have to stop them flanking around to the right-hand side. If I can spin around, let's have a quick glimpse at where the setup position. Where has he gone with it? Where did he go? There you are. Okay, he's come back to his original position.
But he could be rushed through the room.
He's still not decided.
It's not a good position. They can walk through without being seen.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we'll see how it works. We do have even Kiki on the Reaper behind them, okay, which isn't going to offer them too much. And I'm kind of surprised they didn't take a second to see where this Bastion was, who's being healed up and was actually almost dead before. He's going to heal himself too, and this is going to buy actually a lot of time. He's super. It maybe should have taken a couple seconds there and actually looked at what they're up against before they rushed in. Because they rushed last time, remember? And they actually took the point extremely quickly from it.
But the thing is, they only have 2 minutes, so they've got to rush. They've really got to go as quick as possible. But of course, it could be down to they only both capture the first point. It could be down to that.
Yep. And then we keep going.
And then we just keep going. Then we just keep going. Tark's still sticking around the side there, so they didn't hunt him down. They didn't decide to try and find him. Now, this is dangerous because he could deal with that Bastion pretty quickly.
Oh.
A quick Hex Rocket in the backside.
He missed it.
He missed the big right click, and that's deadly. Now he's going to have to try and get away, but it might be enough to distract them.
Where's the rest of the team, though? That's the question. And Wadded. Oh, these are some free kills for him. Actually, he'll die to a query. But Aquiri did lose his mercy, and there's the revive coming through. This time it's going to be defensive out of Coin Flippers to maintain this hold. And now with only 49 seconds left to go, Isuba, they need him to make a decision.
Yeah, I mean, he's got his ulti available, hasn't he, Wotted? Wotted was very accurate on the Tracer in the previous round, so now as soon as they come in, they're coming straight into a big ulti from Bastion.
Winston, Zarya, I would like to see out of them. Winston to jump on the Bastion, put the shield down. Zarya to shield up the Winston so he doesn't die. Then the Genji comes in and assassinates. That's something I would like to see.
They've got to move. They're 20 seconds. Okay, here we go. Final attack coming through. He's going to catch out the one. There's the ulti. No, he didn't get the ulti off just in time. He got picked off. Is that going to be enough? But no, here's going to be the Death Blossom. Tries to get around the side there. It's just going to keep them away from the site. But this may actually have just worked out on the attack. That was tragic. Tragic from Wotted. Done such a fantastic job throughout it. That ulti coming out from the May is not going to be enough to keep them away from sight. Tried to just lock them out of the sight in the last few seconds, but overtime is going to be used, which we don't often see a great deal of lately. And he do manage to cap out that front point. Okay, that was just about as long as they could do it.
Yeah. Okay, so now Coin Flipper is going to be on the attack.
Oh man, that Bastion. He's just had to press Q just a split second earlier.
Yeah, and not to mention you get a lot of extra HP when you hit your ultimate
that's what
too,
I mean.
And your armor.
He would have just instantly boofed himself back up. Okay. Posh English, boofed.
Gosh. All right, so Coin Flippers, what attack are they going with here? We saw Genoan sitting on the Winston. I think they realized, we have 2 minutes and 42 seconds. We've got more time than Isuba had. Maybe it's taking a little bit slower with that Junkrat Zarya or the Roadhog Zarya combo. And if they do have something, cheesy like a Bastion, well, they can pull it through. They can just pull them in. Outside, you got to wait, man. We're not into your game yet. That's the game we're going up to next.
The next match.
Actually, no, it's not even that one. No. I don't know. Is he subbing in for another game of blue? Because he actually might be. Anyways. So if they're looking for this combo, they just need a Hood of Hook and pick up a kill. Wadded, I don't necessarily agree with the Wadded and Kiki combo of the Tracer and Genji because it's just really squishy. When you try to push in, I think someone like a Soldier provides you, a lot of healing, a lot of utility, and not to mention just spam damage if you need it.
Yeah, I mean, I think they're sticking with what worked last time, basically. But the adoption here, as you're talking about with the Tracer, the adoption is the fact that Davsa is this time using Torbjorn, and it might be enough.
He's on B-Fly, that's why. Sorry. Yeah, another game, Blue versus B-Fly is the game we're going to next. But yeah, the Torbjorn, it's in a weird position.
Yeah, he had it over the side, and he wasn't happy, and they just adjusted.
I mean, for what he's put the turret here, it means, we want to contest on the point. We don't want to fight you before you get here, which is really dangerous to do because you lose such valuable choke points to work with.
Well, let's see what Wotted can do this time. Not a lot. He took a hell of a lot of beating, and he got picked off as soon as he came in the doorway. That's not great. So that's going to put them on a 5-on-6. We're going to have Kiki trying to sweep around the side and distract, but The second he gets around the side here, he's going to realize that Torbjörn too.
Oh! That was Dapsa. No, that was Dapsa who shot a bullet right at him, and he reflected it right into the head of the soldier. Oh, and now Kiki, he's going to have ult relatively soon. He takes on PKR. This is a huge win for them.
And Wattid, of course, got took down really early on. He's got back onto point. He's got himself the Lucio with him as well. Takes down Weaver, and that's going to be the Gorilla going down. Is it going to be enough for Winston? No. Primal Rage pops out. He will manage to force him off point, but he didn't contest it enough. Now he's got Neutron Bomb available, but it's not going to be enough to take down that big, angry ape, and he will get swatted down.
Okay, so a minute 50 left to go. They didn't make any progress on that first point, even though they did have people on it. Kiki, though, Dragonblade available soon. Johnny, that's an easy kill for you. Oh, if the Mercy gets a little bit too far pushed out, that's going to be easy pickings.
They're zoning him out nicely here. Look, they're keeping him away from the point. This is working out well. Torbjörn turret just around the side there. The Hog's just going to be used to blow them all backwards while the rest of the team around the side there deal and capture the point. This is a nice, easy capture for them. Unless the Molten Core can keep them at bay, tries to throw the turret in there. Doesn't quite work out that way.
Yeah, that's unfortunately. Dragonblade is up, though, for Kiki. And they're going to be able to push through here. So the other question comes on the defending side of Isuba. Will they have enough defensive ultimates? They need PKR cannot afford to die. If he dies, they might as well just throw away the game at this rate.
Well, this is the big push. Dragonblade could be so huge. And don't forget, Pertu's got that ulti available for the Mercy as well to get the Resurrect. Just needs to stick around the side. Here we go. Dragonblade being used out, trying to get that Winston down. A lot of hit points, not really landing the shots. Does manage to finally cut him down. Gets the Zarya off as well. Misses the Reaper, actually. Goes into Wraithform, keeps him off. But the site is being contested while this all happening. Lucio going to use that sound barrier to keep them away. Just hopping, skipping, jumping. He's got the speed boost on. He's just trying to keep himself away. Will finally get dropped off. There's the counter sound barrier. The Graviton Surge pulls in. They're just going to block them out there. They may try to keep them off site. I don't think it's quite enough. They haven't really captured the point out, and there's only 27 seconds remaining. They had to make this attack work, and it looks like he's backfired.
But Pertu's still there. He's got the actually, he just used the revive, so I think they might continue this attack. The problem is the May is going to be so difficult to deal with. Kiki is eventually going to back away. They have 10 seconds left to go, so they will be going into an overtime. Altus just gets someone on the point, and with Tarka using his ultimate just there, they're going to be down a crucial ultimate that can actually hold the point. So here's the final push, 5 seconds to go.
Someone
needs to get on the point, and he will be able to make it here. So now it's contested, and it comes into this last final attack. The hook comes in, but not the kill.
So close. But mate just gets himself that little shield off, does get frozen up, has to pull off the point there. Everybody's got to keep popping in and out. This overtime can only last so long, and that looks like Perto switched away from the Mercy, switched onto the Tracer, but they've got to keep that overtime ticking, and this is really not one of those maps that's going to work out too well for them. Let's get back onto the point. Anyone on there? No, that is it. So, Jason.
These can last a really long time, because I can see you keep getting invites, because that's the next game.
So now, who picks the next map? It's a coin flip again, isn't it? This doesn't matter. We ignore that. We go to the third map. Am I correct?
I believe so. Yeah. Lobby leader needs
third
to go back.
Map. Lobby.
All right. So
it actually does it go to the King of the Hill now? No, it doesn't. It goes to the third map.
That's the third map.
And we have to have another coin flip decider.
Okay, so now we'll have coin flippers decide.
Oh, Lord. Coin flippers, heads or tails. This is not how I envisioned the first game.
I thought the first round was going to be over.
I thought it'd be like, quick and done, but these guys seem...
Heads. All right, heads. You're with me here.
Okay, here we go. Flip.
Tails.
Tails. Tails.
They should change their name, clearly.
Is. Both of them failed on the coin flip. So, Isuba.
Now we have Dorado, we have Hollywood, Nepal, Gibraltar left.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dorado.
That was a pretty good game, though.
Hollywood.
That was pretty good on Hanamura.
What do we got? Nepal.
I like that, actually.
Nepal or
Gibraltar.
Gibraltar. You watch him go for Gibraltar. Oh. I knew it. I knew they'd go for the longest map.
Of course.
Of course they did.
Well, they should just start whenever, because I think we're actually even holding the bracket up a little bit. I know you're getting invites to the next game already, which is going to be, I believe, B-Fly versus Northern Gaming Blue.
Yep.
If I'm not mistaken. But it looks like we're dropping a game, so let's just kick this one off. Let's get straight into Gibraltar and see who's going to pick up the first or the final map here, or potentially tie it and go to King of the Hill, which could happen, and advance through into the bracket.
Oh, unbelievable. It's crazy that It's crazy the way the game could work sometimes. Like we said, you know, they had 2 minutes. 2 minutes to get those 2 points. They had the overtime, etc. And yet they actually did it. And okay, well, we've gone back to lobby. Oh, one wants a toilet break for 1 minute. If only we had such...
That's why I have bottles.
I couldn't fit into that bottle.
Okay.
Which right. sounds a little wrong.
All right.
Let's talk about the teams that are in there. Let's have a look at what else is going on throughout the tournament. Because
I can look at some other results.
You could probably refresh this and see how it's going. Because they're actually already into round of 32 on some of the games. So we really are holding things up.
Yes, we can show some of it for you guys. We'll just do that real quick. Yeah.
Yep.
Want to show it?
No. All right. Yeah. Let's get to the round of round of 32. There's already a few teams that have already reached there. You can see, obviously, it's going to be Misfits in the top there. They are the top seed. They're going to be playing Hey Guys. You guys not very original with Stone Temple.
This will be a good game, actually.
Stone Temple Overdrive. Stone Temple Overwatch. There we go. Stone Templars Overwatch. Fortress, well, we went to see who they're going to be playing.
I would assume the other team.
The other team. They've been around to go
really good.
Quite a bit.
Yeah. That's like the ex-Battlefield guys plus Drunks.
Melty. Oh, Melty Visiteers, the French battle down there.
Also. Yeah. Later on, we got SG1 up against Nova Silva, Arcilla.
Or PATG Champs going to be against Cabina. They've been
Cabina
doing
of
good
Kamaza.
Work over in Gosu. It's worked out well for them. SG1 in there, of course. A lot of the seeds obviously got themselves a boost. Anox are going to be playing the winner of this. They're going to be watching it, so I'm thinking, come on, sooner or later. Actually, no, they're not. Did I get that wrong?
No, you're right.
They are. Yeah, Anox are going to fall into there. Yes, I'm B-Fly, Northern Gaming. Sorry, guys. Well, I know we're holding your game up. We're just waiting for this one to get completed. Ready.
And then reunite on towards the bottom half of the bracket.
Yeah, reunite so, playing sticks.
So. Just to remind you guys, we will be stopping today's show at the round of 16.
Yes.
Because those games will be played tomorrow and one after another. So they won't be played all at the same time. Yep. We'll do an each match one by one, and it'll be all best of fives to determine the first four teams through into the group finals.
The playoffs, yes. Yep. The big playoffs, of course. Four teams from Europe will qualify for the big finals, which will be happening at Gamescom. And Gamescom's in August. If you guys haven't got your tickets,
good luck getting them now.
It's tough because they're sold out.
Yeah. Are they?
Yeah, they're sold out.
You can watch on stream.
It's Saturday and Sunday. Actually, you know what? I'm not sure if Sunday sold out. Sunday is the finals day, guy.
Yeah. Well, Saturday and Sunday is the Overwatch tournament.
Saturday is definitely sold out. I know all the other days sold out. I'm not sure if Sunday sold out yet. I know the rest of them sold out like ahead of time, like ahead of earlier than normal.
Okay.
Well,
you can still maybe get your tickets. Just go ahead and check it out.
Yeah. Check
meantime,
out the Gamescom site.
Let's drop in a game because we're on to Gibraltar.
Yes.
Our third and potentially final map, assuming we don't have a tie.
I'm just expecting Ilios already. Ilios is the tie map. If we were to get there.
I mean, to be fair though,
soldier on defense.
I'm happy that we have a good match. Other than a stall.
Yes,
I mean,
yes.
Yeah, it does stall us a little bit of extra time, but it's nice to see these teams relatively evenly matched and seeing some good plays across the board.
Well, if you just think back, eSuper were holding that first defensive point on King's Row so well, and then just a couple of mistakes made. The flank came around, and that was enough. But we'll see how it goes. It is a double soldier defensive setup here, along with the Reaper and the Mercy Lucio, and of course the Reinhardt. So they're going to be holding the high ground. Let's see how it works out, because your favorite is going to be on Widowmaker.
I was just going to say that. I mean, Widow, it's a little bit easier to play Widow on a map like Gibraltar, because on Hanamura, there's so much close range battle that it's really hard for you to have any good shots off. But hey, don't laugh. You've done that before. We've all done that before.
I didn't laugh. I don't know what you mean. Did you hear me laugh? I didn't laugh.
I heard a little...
That was no. That was me sneezing.
Okay.
Sneezing
anyways, quality. So they've been able to get the high ground initially. They should ideally be able to get this first point without much of a problem. Most teams don't really bother to contest it. But the double soldier, though, it's going to be really hard to push this point. Like, the damage that they can output is just ridiculous. I don't know why Genoa's that far pushed up. He's going to have to back off. And Targu has finally been able to pick up a kill.
Yeah, finally. The first kill of the game, actually, I feel. So here we are, PKR going up high. They're going to try and get the flankeroo. I actually don't really want to be looking at these. I want to be looking at these. And he is going to land that headshot. Oh, and that's going to be the Mercy going down as well around the backside. So you should be able to push on round. But Kiki just kind of ruin the party by coming flanking around the back, and that Wraithform's just going to hold him.
Delaying the inevitable.
Delaying the inevitable indeed, as you say. And they should be able to catch out that first point. Let's switch across to somebody that's
Let's look at the soldiers. Let's look at Wadid or Amali, actually, because I'm curious where they're going to go position themselves. We've seen a lot of teams position soldiers with the Mercy on top of the actual shuttle because of the amount of damage they can do with the falloff that they don't have at long range. But Aquarius is already going to pretty much eliminate any possibility for that one, taking on one soldier and the Mercy. And coin flippers, they have to be careful. This game is being snowballed extremely quickly against them.
Yeah, and they're going to get the Infrasight on as well, so they know exactly where that Reaper is. The Monkey's trying to chase him down. Weaver getting in around there for the Winston. Kind of forgot the payload, but they have got control of the shuttle, which is the main objective at the moment. To get that shuttle, pretty much push through unhindered. Taku trying to get around the side. If he can catch down that Widowmaker, does manage to land two shots, but not going to be enough. The rest of it, though, is going to be the Widowmaker. Genji even going through there.
But you can see, though, because she didn't get the kill, or because he didn't get the kill, she got the revive off in the end towards the other side of the wall. And we'll have a second chance to actually defend this with the help of the Sound Bear. It's actually really well timed and really well communicated within the team. But is it going to be enough? Because at this rate, they're still just getting walked over.
Well, it's going to be an ulti coming out from both soldiers in a moment. So this is going to work out well. There's going to be one. There's going to be the second running down. Don't think Weaver's going to be surviving this one. And the payload will continue on.
So you have to think now, if he picked up that kill onto Mercy on a PKR, or sorry, onto Pertu, would that have been the point captured? Well, they have gotten stopped there, and I think they wouldn't have. Mm. And that could have been, you know, a major downfall. But luckily, it doesn't matter about time. It just matters about finishing the game.
I mean, he is landing the shots, but sadly he's not landing the full shots. He's just getting
he's not hitting the weak shots,
yeah.
The buy shots don't do as much anymore. But the heads do technically equal damage as they would have before at full charge.
I mean, it is. Oh, that, see, there we go. We can land them just now and again. 1 in 10. It's all good. Oh, so close to capturing that one. Okay. We're not going to focus on him too much because I'm going to see the Death Blossom. Unfortunately, didn't do a great deal. It got pretty much shielded out completely. We see Wotted back on the Winston. I honestly kind of preferred him on Tracer, and this is one of the maps that Tracer would have worked quite well on. Could get the flank around. He was landing the shots. He was pretty damn accurate with
it. Yeah, it's just that Tracer's typically better on attack than defense because you don't want to push too far behind the team because the payload keeps moving and you're just like, we can't do much about it. But yeah, I mean, they kind of needed the Winston to pair in with the Reinhardt. But necessarily don't think they needed the Reinhardt. You could have went with like a Roadhog-Zarya combo, a Roadhog-Winston combo, or a Zarya-Winston combo, and it would have provided you more actual firepower when it comes to head-on-head fight. But here's where you need the Reinhardt, because you need to be able to hit, sit behind these shields, especially if you're Mala on the soldier, to be able to protect.
Well, Aquiri's been doing some pretty interesting work throughout the game, working out well, trying to get the flank around, might be able to get the Mercy down. Yes, he will. That's going to be the barrage. That's all he wanted from that barrage. Just a single kill is all he really needed to net from that one. Unfortunately for him, the Genji will get taken down. There's PKR getting the res off just in time. And that's going to bring everybody else back alive around the side there. You did hear the tactical visors getting popped off, but the payload is not moving at the moment. They need to get back around to it. They kind of left it in status quo, so they got that little greedy momentum where you go for the kills and forget the payload.
Oh, Mercy, you gotta stay alive, or you cannot die, and he gets taken down. Burtu, you need to stay alive, son. It's really hard. I understand that, especially with the Query, who's been having a phenomenal game on Pharah. And luckily for him and his team, it looks like they haven't been able to defend for a little bit longer, so they will have some time to buy for him to get back in and join the group.
Mirage is gonna be back available in a moment as well. You're gonna see the sound barrier available. Winston, well, I see what he's doing. He's trying to harass as much as he can, but he's left his team in a 5v6 situation with Barrage. He's flanking around the back once again. This time around, he's going to catch him in the back, and that gets a double just before he goes down. Make that a triple. Tark getting the shot off as well. Death Blossom tracking him with it. There's going to be the revive, though. Is it going to be enough to catch him back in there? No. All easy. Push coming on. They're going to have one last chance at defending this.
And with the Reaper up close and personal, it's going to be so hard to push this position, especially with ulted speed use. And Janowon, he has Earthshatter. He just needs to hit it from the side to buy them a little bit of time. And there it will go off. Does he have the backup? PKR is going to die, so that's no Mercy potential revive coming through, though he did use it before. But Tarku, I mean, this might go to him real quick, because he's not being touched. He's not being dealt with here. He's been on this Widowmaker for almost the entire time, especially towards this end. And when he's not being attacked because he has a Query able to push in and draw some attention, he's picking up kills left and right.
Well, they've held it off just for now. Mala's managed to get his ulti ready. Kiki actually switched. Watted also switched. He switched again. He'd actually almost built his Tracer. He'd gone for the Tracer spam there, but he switched back over to Genji. Watted also switched to Winston as well.
It's to do with Tarku, because they seriously have nothing except Mala, which you can't count a soldier to beat a Widowmaker in a 1v1, especially at long range. He has to be the one to deal with them, but they don't have an answer for Inquiry still. Tactical Advisor.
Not sure.
A little
that.
Bit questionable.
Yeah.
Not say that it's the smartest of uses out of him. But now they have to deal with the decision you made. So he didn't pick up any kills. The team has to come together and defend this point.
Yeah, not sure on that at all, especially when Inquiry, you want to be saving things for this man because he's been flanking around and getting that rocket barrage off quite successfully a number of times. And here he goes again, getting around the side there. There's going to be the rocket barrage. Doesn't do as much this time around. Does manage to get the kill on Mala, though. There's going to be the follow-up as well with a single left click. The Death Blossom comes through. Doesn't quite get the kills he was looking for. So it hasn't been as successful on this push, but he may well have just done enough. You can see the monkey going wild in there. That's going to be Weaver trying to get down as much as he can, but not really made great deal of difference with the payload. They can still see contesting it. The monkey's going to be jumping in and out.
And Tark's still not being dealt with. He's still just getting free reign towards the backside. Weaver's just trying to provide that strong frontline advantage. And not to mention, they're trying to rush the point. Coin Flippers just trying to defend as long as they can. What is just swinging away, trying to delay as long as he possibly can. But it's not based on time. It's based on completion. And they're not picking up kills. This should be the end of it. This should be Suba picking up the 4-0.
And there we go. So Isuba managed to complete Gibraltar. Can Coin Flippers do the same? Or will we be going to Ilios? Because it is all about whether they complete it. No time.
Yep.
Which actually wasn't too bad. They had 251 remaining, so they did it in a pretty decent time overall.
So what we've seen out of Coin Flippers is something that a lot of top teams maybe struggle with, but they're doing relatively well, is by saving the Lucio ultimate towards after or for after the revive out of Mercy, because that gives you so much extra longevity. The Mercy's going to die most likely when she goes in for like the 3-4 man revive. You use the Lucio ultimate off the back of that to give yourself some extra HP and some extra time, most importantly, to just group up and position yourself correctly, because you're not obviously going to die in the most ideal locations. They're doing that really well. The problem is they're not dealing with the key targets. Tarku and Inquiry is just not being handled at all. And that's what's giving you Suba the control. If they had someone that could take them on, if they had a fair of their own, they actually could be winning this game. They could have held Suba back.
Taku's switched this time around, gone onto the Soldier. 76 along with Davsap. Actually, no, he's going back to spawn, so he's going to switch out again. So let's see if he switches off to something different. Reinhardt, Mercy in there, Lucio, of course.
No.
He's going to go to Reaper. Okay.
I don't know. See, I don't necessarily 100% like Reaper on this first point. Well, on the very first point, because you don't really contest
it's close
it too
range
much.
And it's such a wide open space.
Exactly. You don't really contest it too much. I guess you're trying to deal with anyone that rushes you. You let the Soldier deal with the long range, even a query on the Pharah. He's good, though, if you build up the ultimate into this next part. The hangar phase gets a little bit risky as well, depending on how your team wants to fight. And he's having a little bit of... There you go. They want to make it up there. They're able to get across and join his team. They might actually go for a quick push around the corner to actually fight them right off the bat, because you're not really losing much in the end of that one. But instead, they're going to sit back, let Inquiry do his thing on this Pharah, which has been honestly performing so damn well so far in this entire series.
Yeah, it's been working well. But this time, of course, as you mentioned, no Reinhardt shield, which kind of helps to get around that corner, especially around here. But instead, they're using the Hog. Now, if that shield goes down, it's been worked pretty hard, and now it will get knocked down. Does land the Hog, hit the hook in the air. Doesn't manage to take down the Pharah, though. A little disappointed he couldn't follow it through. He was talking about the Reaper. Reaper did get through the back there and managed to get a couple of kills, and they've held him at bay fairly successfully before the first point.
This is where things get really, really difficult. If you're playing Roadhog against a Reaper, well, you're basically screwed. Right? It's so hard for you to actually be able to win out on a 1v1, let alone stay alive when a Reaper is going to be on your backside. Capone, though, just hasn't really been attacked too much, able to get a lot of extra healing towards his team, trying to help focus down these targets one by one. And now the fact that he has 75% on his ult charge already means his push into the next point should be relatively easy, but he's gone down.
Oh, that's two of them down as well. Managed to take down Kiki as well, switched back into the action. It's going to be Mala around the side there, but that's Weaver going down as well. So the Reinhardt down, that's going to be the first checkpoint reached. It's the easy one. It's normally uncontested getting to that checkpoint. Now, they normally, what happens to pro teams, they'll sit around the side, run this, sit around in the server room and just push around the side there. But now, because they went with that early aggression, we're seeing why teams tend to do this, because they've got so close to that second checkpoint, almost uncontested once they cleared out that the Reinhardt down.
He didn't chase the Mercy. Why didn't he chase the Mercy? Okay, so maybe because Wedded was already there to actually do that one. So they pick up the kill into PKR, which means they have no revive. He's already so close to it. Tactical Visor is being used. This one out of Dafsa, which I don't know if he's even on the high ground. No, he's on the low ground, which is even harder, especially with the forklift in the way. Yeah, it gives you more cover, but also eliminates the potential for you to pick up kills because of just objects and terrain being in your way, and he's going to be taken down by Kiki here.
Well, this is going to be working well. That's the clear on site. Weeber getting dropped. Oh, the revive comes through. The big resurrect on point. And he actually almost stayed alive. No, PKR gets picked off. Wotted going through there as well. We do hear the Reaper Death Blossom coming through. Didn't get a great deal from it. Just simply took Wotted down there. Kiki's going to get picked off it. And we're just about blocks away. Runs straight into a Soldier 76. Dafsa not having any of that.
That was like 2v5 on the point. The Reaper and the Reinhardt. And somehow they still survived. I'm not sure how the hell that should even happen or even be allowed out of a team. But Jedi1 able to pick up two kills with the help of the Graviton Surge, and will eventually fall after picking up a third, and they will finally capture this point in just a second's time.
Once Reaper comes out of Wraith form, we'll finally get picked off there. Something you should never really see, Mercy and Lucio together catching themselves both the same rocket from afar.
Yeah, that's never good.
No.
That's never good. I think the position in general out of both Mercies has been a little bit rough, but honestly, that's the hardest part of playing support, is your positioning, and especially when you know, you don't know the direction they're coming from, or especially if you know, if you're querying your team who's been able to catch off Pertu so many times on his Mercy. Gotta be careful. They've been able to maintain the high ground. They don't have anyone to contest it so far. They have a Genji and a Soldier, but that's basically it. You're counting on this hook out of Jedi1 to pull him out of position, but as long as Weaver keeps up that shield, you're not gonna have an opportunity.
Little discussion there. Taku switched to Widowmaker, switched to Reaper and switch back to Soldier. Dafsa, meanwhile, going to drop around. Oh, Mercy
perfect.
Completely on her own there. And this is going to be a clean wipe from the backside. They were not expecting that. Beautifully done from Dafsa.
That was honest. That wasn't anything wrong Pertu did. Not at all. Like, he was in a bad spot, but he was actually waiting for his team to die because these ultimates to revive him. He just got caught off by Dafsa being really, really aware of where the Mercy could potentially be. And you're not going to miss with your ultimate up either. So, really good pulled out of them. And they're continuing this pace.
Just trying to pop the ulti. He's going to get revived, resurrected up on the side there. Keep calling it revive. I mean, it's the same name, depending what game you're going to be calling it. It's the same jobs, does the same thing. But this is an unchecked Roadhog coming around the backside. Almost got himself a double there onto the two supports. But they do manage to back away around the corner. But it's enough to keep that payload moving. The hook just about missing on towards the Mercy there. And that's going to be quick work coming out from Taku this time around with that ulti.
Somehow, PKR, I don't know how he gets so lucky so often.
he was so lucky to get away from that.
He really was. That hook, I mean, you can argue maybe it should have hit, but still, just to, I guess, kind of jump away at the nick of time. This is a key fact for him to be able to survive that one. But
we should start talking about the fact that actually we only have 3.5 minutes left.
Yeah.
And they have been held at the shuttle bay, which is generally the hardest choke point to get past. Let's see if Genji can do his magic here. Isn't really catching them out. Does manage to get the Soldier down, but it's not enough. He got picked off by a Lucio from behind there.
It just seems like they're only pushing really hard when Kiki has his ultimate available. And again, PKR getting out of position, gets called off. They're actually successfully going to look to take this point, it seems, because the res has already been used. PKR used it just prior. There's a tactical visor coming through, but it's not picking up kills. Dafsa is going to get pushed into a really bad position. He catches up Capone, though, before he does go down. And he will get on the payload for a split second and eventually be meleeed to his death. Query, you cannot, no, you need to not die here.
Meleeed by Pertu as well, so it always feels good for a Mercy to get the kill. So there we go. Final checkpoint reached. Now let's see if they can complete the map.
They've coin flippers need a
Reinhardt. 4.5 minutes to do this.
Mm-hmm. They need a Reinhardt,
totally
they want
doable.
To as well.
Yeah.
Like switch out Jedi1 off the Roadhog to a Reinhardt. The problem, again, it's like you have to depend on your DPS players to do the work to be able to switch to a Reinhardt. Because you need to be able to have that shield to push up around these corners to allow your DPS to pick up kills. But it's all up to Kiki and Wadded to really do much. And Tarku's going to fail the jump a little bit, but he won't fail the shot. That's a Genji now down. That's basically a big chunk of their DPS gone. And now Mala, he has nothing to combo his ultimate with.
Weaver's keeping them at bay. Earth Chatter goes down. That should smash out the Mercy. Barrage coined in with it. So they really are trying for the big delay tactic. Not sure I agree with the double ulti link up there, because they'd already kind of done the damage and forced one back, so they were going to have to slow down the attack. Now they're going to have to build up. But you know what? If it buys them 30, 40 seconds, it's all good.
Yeah, it definitely will. Now, not that I had a major ult disadvantage, but as you can see, Lucio Mercy combos up with their ultimates. So what they're going to do again is the whole team is probably going to die here. They'll use the revive, pair it in with the Sand Bear to make them actually survive this one. There's the Graviton Surge coming through. Pertu, he's actually been pulled into it. He's been taken down. They don't have the revive.
Is it going to be enough? That's the question. It's going to pick him around the side. Aquiri is still doing some serious, serious work on this Pharah. Seems to be untouched every time I look at him. So manages to pick them off the side there. Manages to blow Jai one off. We were talking about how he needs to switch away. And I think it may well be time. They need that Reinhardt shield around this side at the moment because every time they have that attack, it just falls short.
Well, look at Kiki now. He's switched over to the Widowmaker. I think he did some decent damage. They're finally trying to challenge on Aquiri to not let him play so safe, which is something they should have been doing, honestly, a long time from now. And Tarku, yeah, that soldier's gonna take it out any day of the week here. But the push is still going. Yusuma picked up 3 kills. The revive, well, PKR's dead. He doesn't have it available.
Not wanted behind them. It's like, hello? There is a soldier shooting you in the backside. I guess it's like we'll choose the better of two evils, and they're both fighting on them. I don't even think they're going to get respawned in Contessius. I think this is going to be going. Would you believe it? I think we're going to be going to Ilios. I think this is going to happen. There we go. The final round completed.
What's wrong, Lee?
It's like the never-ending game. It already is. We talked about this at the start. Could we go the distance? So we've had 3 draws. 3 draws.
Yeah.
Well. All right.
Nothing wrong with that.
All right. All right.
Just didn't expect it to be so early on the bracket. No. So, Ilios. Best 3 on Ilios will determine the winner, unless they somehow tie, which has been impossible, hopefully, on this. And we still have teams waiting
for us.
You
can't tie on this. You can't tie in this. It's all good.
They could just stall out in overtime for 25 minutes.
Oh, right, with the Tracer spam. Possible.
Maybe.
I don't think it's going to happen.
But though, thinking about it, this should be a game that Yusuma should win just based off Pharah performance alone. Pharah is really strong on all 3 points on this map. Especially Wells, she's extremely strong, really hard to deal with. Even on the first point on Lighthouse, a little bit difficult. I want to give it to them just based off that alone, but somehow coin flippers have held on now for 3 maps straight. Yeah. It really can be anyone's game.
We haven't actually seen Kiki going back to the Pharah. He used Pharah in the first map on King's Row, but I haven't seen him pulling back to it. Maybe just got
well, I think he lost
so
many times. Yeah,
to his query. He's just like, I can't. It's not working.
No confidence.
Chaos, yeah.
Yeah. And confidence is so key, especially when you're Pharah Mercy battles. Being able to hit those prediction rockets is so damn difficult. Okay. Well, we'll just let them go ahead and start this one off because we want to get this one underway since we have still so many teams waiting. B-Fly versus Northern Gaming Blue is the game we'll be going up to next. It'll probably be an extremely quick break once we do finish this game.
Yes.
Because they're, well, they've
we're
been
ready
adding
to go as soon as we finish.
Yeah, yeah, they've been adding you this whole time.
Yeah, I might as well deal with that while I'm actually waiting. 1,000,001 people added me. Doop, 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 doop. Even a couple of casters as well. They're all sat there going, will this game ever end?
Never ending game. But yeah, let's go and tell them to start because we want to get this one underway. They've already had a minute break to go to the bathroom. They don't need another for this.
I've told them we're ready. Told them, Jace.
You should be lucky. I'm not sitting there. I'd be like, start the game now, or I'm going to come to your place and not do anything because I'm a wuss. Yep. No, there's no coin flip.
You're going to go to their place and set off some fireworks because it is
4th of July.
It is. Yeah, so Miracle. You don't really get to celebrate it here, do you? It's just like nobody cares in Germany.
I should have actually worn like an American flag shirt.
You could have.
But I didn't want to invest that much.
Full American suit with the hat as well.
Yeah, but the Jew in me is like, I don't want to spend that much money. So, yeah, we're in the game. Ilios, let's drop in.
Ilios.
See how this one goes.
Okay. Well, I mean, okay. So, basically, this is going to be the 3 points they're going to capture. We're starting out on the ruins, by the looks of it. Yes. Straining around the side there, of course. Well, and Lighthouse. It's not going to be the 5 that you'll get in competitive. It would be that way if it was Nepal was chosen as an actual map to play in regular time, but we are in effectively overtime here. Our own version of overtime, which is a tiebreaker. And of course, we cannot have draws this time around, thankfully. So somebody will finally win this game. Eventually.
Eventually. Yeah, so on Ruins, let's see, Double Tracer, Lucio, Double Lucio, Tracer. Okay. So Yusuma still have high mobility with the Double Lucio, but not necessarily as high as coin flippers with the Double Tracer. So they're really looking for the up close and personal fights, where Tarku, though, is more than happy to sit back on that Widowmaker and just allow this to buy him some time. But Pertu is actually, he switched away from Mercy to Pharah.
Yeah, that's a bit of a change.
That's a major change.
There's no, I mean, they've gone with the Lucio. A single Lucio versus the Double Lucio. That's a very, very ballsy tactic. coming out of the coin flippers.
Whoa, what are you doing, Pertu? You can't dive in that not unless you have Barrage. You got to be more careful on that. You got to sit back a little bit further and lay down some suppressing fire or something from the back. But either way, he's gone down. Misuba have or will get control of the first point in just a few seconds. But Molly's able, well, no, he's not really been able to build too much ult percent. Yeah, he has a lot of damage on his beam with 87% charge. But his ult's only about 30%.
So a query going onto the Tracer instead of the Pharah, which he's been playing the whole way through. And obviously has that bomb ready and waiting to go. You're going to see them capping out the point, starting to build it up. We'll get contested out, but as you mentioned, they're going to have their ultis charging up already here. And you've already seen the bombs going out. I think he just bombed himself, didn't he?
I think he rewound into it. It was around a corner. I'm not sure.
I think he did.
I don't know, he died himself.
To it, you know?
No, I'd love to. Okay, so Tarku, I guess we should tag along with him for a little bit just to see, is he going to be challenged out on? Kiki has switched over to Widow, so have a Widow v Widow battle, but he can already see him coming, and well, you're not going to win that battle when she knows you're going to be there.
Yeah.
And that will give him a little bit more control. So by maybe about 20, 30% more, assuming that the rest of the team can hold.
Well, we'll see. It's a rather large assumption, but judging by the rest of the game so far, but this is looking like a pretty solid hold. We talked about this at the start. You were thinking Isuba might well have it in them to hold them completely in. Nobody's dealing with Jam 1 around the side. He's just got around the back of them. They're kind of ignoring. He's got the Primal Rage going, but without the rest of his team, he's going to try and knock them off the map. Not going to work out. And without the rest of his team to back him up, which finally are arriving, he's not going to be doing a lot, even though his ult is used.
There's really not much reward to, as a dies. Solo Winston, to actually jump on the point with your ultimate, Primal Rage, to buy time. Because when it's contesting, you're still giving them percent. And yeah, you're just giving them more ult percent, and then you're not alive and no ultimate available when your team does finally get there. So it's a little bit risky to do that. But already at 82%, looks like Isuba's just going to pull off the full hold. We're seeing we saw the triple trade, so now just double. And Pertu has to hit a good pulse bomb here if they want to have a chance of even capturing this point.
Okay, they got Sound Barrier, Graviton Surge, and Pulse Bomb all ready to go. It should be a nice little lineup. Yes, there we go. Pertu gets himself the double. They do finally line up the kills and manage to get themselves the ultis layered in. But is it enough? Can they capture out the point? Because it's still being contested. Don't forget that double Lucio still sticking around. PKR and Wachulka. Wachulka gets taken down. PKR is going to be running in, but he's finally decided back away, join the rest of his team. Weber's just going to hold position at the moment. So the double tracer switch from Pertu and Wattit finally pays off, but it was really down to Mala's Graviton Surge.
Exactly, yeah. And you can't depend on that to win a fight every single time. It's just not going to be available. And we were able to push through, able to actually shove out Mala, keep him away. So Mala doesn't have really a chance to really do too much, but he's able to survive this one for the most part. The rest of the team's rushing through. He gets stuck with a pulse bomb. It's launched off the map, and pulse bombs are being thrown left and right. Tarku kills himself with his own Venomine. No, Widowmaker. He comes with his own Widowmine.
Well, I mean, we're finding new and improved ways to kill yourselves. That's what they're doing. But, you know, despite that, they've actually managed to hold the site, which is impressive. So Davsat trying hard to build up this ulti. Does take a long time on Zaya.
Here it is.
Still managing to pick them off. Now, this is exactly what worked against them. There's the Graviton Surge, but he killed himself when he went in there.
Oh, so he had to go past the shield to use it, but at the same time, he killed herself and there was no backup. There was no Tracer ultimates. I mean, Aquarius, if you just wait a little bit longer, he's already at 95%. He could have had it up, and there's the Death Blossom coming through, forcing Weaver to use his Primal Rage just to survive. And the point is just still taking it. It's still in Coin Flipper's hands.
But that I would take. I would take that. Forcing the Death Blossom out, because that can be one of the game enders for you. So just using a Winston ult. But now we've got a double Winston with a double Tracer. So they've switched away from what was working, honestly. They clearly didn't feel that confident with it, with the double Tracer wanted Pertu. So now we're at 84% to 99%. There's the neutron bomb. He could land it nicely. Doesn't catch it onto Weaver. That's what he wanted to do. Sound barrier comes down. This is the big attack. This is the one that should work out well for them. But Wattit hasn't been dealt with. Finally gets popped down on site. Janeway has switched to the one that's actually on site. There we go. One of the monkeys. We'll get there in there eventually. But now it's going to get capped out. They are getting cleared out. Weaver's in there. Everybody in there. Tarku once again standing overwatch. And actually landing shots this time around.
Yeah, and they honestly needed it out of him, especially. Gets another one of Kiki, looking for maybe a third. Well, behind the statue, but nonetheless, they've been able to finally get control of the point yet again. Both teams at 99%. The overtime is ticking away. The Tracers, the Winston's going to be rushing in to buy some extra time and looking to turn this one around.
Well, you can see the neutral bomb going to get thrown in. Not going to catch out, but it doesn't matter because Davsa gets the kill. ticking away. Very quick ulti is being charged up here. Now we see the Tracer spam. Now we see Janua switching across to it as well. Are they going to be able to get in on site? Are they going to keep it? Because the problem is the ruins. It's a long run to the spawn.
That's why you're seeing five Tracers come in out of coin flippers and the Lucio component to help speed them through. Give them a little bit extra healing, not to mention Tracers have a lot of sustain by themselves, but the overtime will continue to tick away. Weeper is honestly... It's really rough for him to do too much against this because a Winston, yeah, he's decent against a Tracer, but once you get some range between you and there's five of them, you're not really going to survive.
Well, the sound barrier. Oh, it was at 93%. That may well have been enough to help them out there. But we still do have four Tracers alive trying to run in that moment. Weaver, though, with that primal rage. And more importantly, Winston does very good against Tracers.
Yeah. As long as he can keep close. And luckily for him, the point's made for him to stay close to people. But it's still in overtime, still taken away. We're seeing Kikina switch over to Winston to help deal with the other Winston he's up against. In overtime, it's finally taken down. The Gravitas are just going to buy a little bit of time. And Isuba will finally, after a hell of a lot of time, pick up that first point.
Considering they got up to 99% to zero,
yeah,
it certainly took them a long time to close it out there. So, Tracer spam or not, it's proven unsuccessful. And Isuba hold on to the first map now. Will we see the game closed out here on the Lighthouse? That's the question. That is the question, Jason. It's the ultimate question. It's the ultimate question in everyone's minds. Everybody's souls.
Can souls have questions?
I don't know. I mean, ask your own soul.
Mine doesn't talk to me anymore.
Damn, we've got deep and philosophical.
All right. Yeah, kicking off the next point. This one going to be on Lighthouse. So we're seeing the double Tracer, double Lucio, the Winston, and the Roadhog for coin flippers. A double Lucio, the Zarya Reaper, Winston, and Tracer out of Isuba. I like Isuba's actual comp here. If Tarku can get in position on point, it's going to be really hard for anyone on coin flippers to really deal with them.
Yeah, deal with those Winstons as well. Should be pretty easy for them to pick them off. The same with the Hog. The Hog takes a hell of a beating from this. You can see he's just getting picked out by that Reaper. Working out well. The Winston's not going to be able to survive too long either.
All percent you get.
Very easy to cap out.
Out of Tarku, like on Reaper against a Roadhog is just insane.
Are they going to change out, I wonder? Are they going to realize, okay, this is not going to work against a Reaper? Yes, they have. The Pharah comes in from Pertu instead. Not sure if that's the right choice. I'm really interested how we've gone from Pertu being the Mercy to Kropon and Mala now being the Lucios and Pertu being a Pharah.
Well, and Mala, who was playing like the flex tank role, playing support.
Yeah.
So it's just like, I mean, maybe he's the only one that feels confident to play Pharah in this lineup. Which is honestly a really rough change. Hopefully it's not because he can't play Lucio. That would be an excuse I would never accept, I think. But Pertu, he's been able to at least get some decent damage in. It's still really hard for him to survive without a Mercy in the air. I mean, there's not really much against him, but it's still really difficult if you take chip damage to kind of sustain on that high ground into the air. But 38% for Isuba. If they take this point and win, it's over. They will finally have been able to move in through to the next round.
Yeah, Taku's doing a great job here. You can see all the ultis charged up and ready to go. Taku does finally get picked down, though. That's going to be the Neutron Bomb in there. Weber did pop his ulti at the same time. PKR, though, double sound barrier available, but he gets picked off as the sound around the side there. And we need to have some changes. I think we need to have some changes. Is it going to be enough to try and get in? He does get the hook himself on a Tracer, but couldn't follow him. And then almost get knocked off the map.
He pulled her a little bit too far. But he's on point. He's at least contesting it so far. But will you have an opportunity to really kill anyone? The Death Blossom is going to come in. It's going to push him away. And now they're in a rough spot where they could be knocked off by a boot from Lucio. But Tarku coming around from the side. Don't shoot just yet. And he gets want to get a little bit closer to the Pharah. But he's just been able to do some really heavy work here on this Reaper. Anyone in close range is just going to have too tough of a time. It's going to be too difficult for them to actually take a Reaper on 1v1.
He's risking it, going past the opening there with the double Lucios. But we'll finally get dropped down, and I think the point is actually going to get attack capped. There we go. Won't get contested in time. Oh, look at that. So close. Weaver jumps in, jumps out. Now it's going to be contested. 95%. And finally, we see coin flippers start to get some action.
It's very reminiscent of Ruins.
Yes.
The first point where Yusuba get 99%, then coin flippers able to turn it around. Or at least maybe flip the situation on its head. Ooh. Or tails. Depends on which way they wanted to go. And Pertu, Barrage, gonna get one. Gonna get the assist on the second. Won't get the third. So not really honestly that much of a value out of the Barrage that he did throw down. But it's been able to give them a little bit of positioning. It's been able to give them control of the inside, most importantly. And could actually give them the game.
Yeah, that's kept them away. Farah, oh, I don't think you're going to be coming back from this one. You've gone too far away. He's going to get the boost, but will not get quite close enough. Can't drift in there. Pertu picks him off from range. Overtime triggered. Here comes the tracers. Is it going to be enough? The Graviton Surge just keeps them away, and that's going to be beautifully set up for Tarku, who we were talking about throughout the game, obviously, talking about his Widowmaker work, but you can't argue with his Reaper work. That was fantastic. He kind of dominated that map.
Well,
we have a game finally over.
We have finally
actually won.
Finished a game. Whew, that one took quite a long time, but nonetheless, Suba will move through. Maybe not the way they expected, maybe the way they wanted to, but they get through nonetheless. They get a damn good warm-up from it.
That took like an hour and a half.
Yep.
That was a long game.
Yep, that was a rough one.
That was a long game. Ah, so, Tarku, 39 kills. I thought so. 108% kill participation, that's quite impressive.
Yeah, I think that's a bug, actually. Yeah. I've seen that a couple times now. We're like 102s, 108s now, but
yeah.
Nonetheless, it shows kind of his performance in that one. I still kind of question his Widowmaker in the earlier rounds, but it seemed to have really kind of come to life as the game went on. Maybe he got his warm-up needed. Maybe he just got home from work, too, and ran to his computer, threw his pants off, and was like, all right, let's go. Let's get this one going underway. But that means we need to go to a short little break before we kick off the next game.
Yes.
We need maybe a washroom break.
Maybe. Maybe just a short one. Very short one. Don't worry, guys. We'll be ready to go. It's going to be Northern Gaming Blue up against
B-Fly.
Banana Fly. So should be a pretty good game. Should be a pretty good game. That's going to be next. Stay tuned.